Good evening, Lighthouse Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us by way of live stream this evening. Sure, not a way that I would want to be with you tonight. Love to be in person. Thank you for your support, your encouragement during these very challenging days, no doubt. Just a little different format. Just kind of wanted to come in the office and just kind of share my heart, I guess, with you this evening. We are seeing such hurt, such heartache right now. Just our church family is going through so much and just all different areas of life, our world, our community. And we're going to begin with a word of prayer. I hope that you'll pray with us and this evening. But several things just to be praying about. Continue to be praying for the Bridges. Miss Bridges, continue to be with her. She's there in the hospital. Hopefully be coming home here shortly. And then also be praying for Brother Registers. He's still sick and not feeling well. I pray that you would just continue to lift him up in prayer. Then also I do want to make mention of Pastor Rob Tenney, Miss Beverly. They've been fighting the coronavirus, and they've had some very difficult days over these last several days. Sammy Allen, he was a great preacher. One that many of us knew. He passed away this past week from the COVID-19, and pray for him and his family. Another missionary that we've heard of that's passed away, not one that we supported because of the virus as well. It just seems like I'm hearing more and more of it here of late, more people sick, and just more people just going through some very difficult days. And we need to just continue to just ask God to be a part of our church, and help us and help these that are struggling. And we're going to have just a moment of prayer. As we pray, would you pray with me and just ask God just to work in hearts? And this is our Wednesday night adult Bible study and prayer time. So join me in prayer as we pray for those that are hurting. Pray for our nation. Pray for the upcoming election. Of course, we know it's so important. And so let's be praying for that as well. But Father, we do love you. Thank you for your goodness to us. I pray you'd help us tonight, Lord God, as we come to you. Lord, we want to honor you this evening. We want to please you. Lord, we want to, gather around your word. Lord, as we gather around our families and we, Lord God, just hear your word. Lord, we are thankful, Lord, that we have this opportunity by way of live stream to come and speak to our church family. And so, Father, I pray you'd encourage them. Lord, there are many that are hurting, maybe sickness, financially, Lord God, things with their family, Father, businesses and financially. Father, the loss of loved ones and just challenging things that our church people are going through. And I just pray, Lord, that you would be with them. I pray you'd encourage them and help them, Lord God. I pray, Lord, you just let them know, Lord God, that you're there with them. And Lord, help us to trust you during these days. We do pray for our community. We pray for our world. We pray for our president, Lord God. We just pray, Lord, your hand upon this great nation. I pray, Lord God, that America would get back to honoring you and pleasing you. Father, we pray for those, Lord, that just need a touch tonight. Lord, we do pray for the Sammy Allen family, Lord God. And Father, I just pray, Lord, you'd be with them, Lord, in this great loss. Lord, I think of Rob and Pastor Rob and Miss Beverly, Lord God. And Lord, Brother Register, Lord, I just pray that you would help them right now, Lord, as they're dealing with this virus. And God, I just pray that you would just help them, Lord, and strengthen them. And Father, we'll thank you for what you're going to do there. Help us now as we open your word, speak to our hearts. We need you in Christ's name. Amen. Well, church, you know, a little over a year ago, I just kind of wanted to take this evening and just kind of just share maybe what the Lord is doing in our lives that I pray that would help you in whatever that you're going through. And I guess just sharing my heart as a pastor and I pray that it might be a help and kind of why I wanted this format also, just a little bit more personal, I guess. But as you know, a little over a year ago, God placed a little blessing in our home, not something that we sought out, but something that God allowed to happen. And little Ivy has been living with us over a year now. And she's been, of course, anybody that's ever met her, you know that she's just a special young lady. And she's not lack of words, and she's got much personality, and she's full of life. And she's from day one, from the moment, I'll never forget us sitting around the bed and having our family devotions that first night and hearing her little heart. And she was spilling it out to a family that she did not know. And she wanted to go to God in prayer. And so we appreciate her little heart. But I guess it was on Sunday, June 28th, as many of you know, and I'm sharing some of this because some, and I guess I'm sharing this too because I've had many ask, you know, what's going on, what's taking place, and sometimes I feel like most folks know and they don't. So I wanted to share this and then come to really what I want to help us with tonight. And I just thought just sharing our story a little bit might be an encouragement to somebody else as we're still walking through some difficult days and things that we will continue to have to deal with. But on June 28th, Ivy ingested a button battery. That's like a small watch battery. We had put her down. Amy had put her down for bed. And she had a toy, and it had one of those little batteries in it. And she was a six-year-old girl and just intrigued with the little bright and shiny battery that she was able to get out of her toy. And she put it in her mouth, and she swallowed it. Ashlyn had come upstairs and saw that she heard her coughing and asked what happened, and she immediately said that she had swallowed the battery. And they took her to the hospital, and I was on my way to preach a camp in Arkansas, me and Kyle, and Amy had called me and told me what had happened, and I really just thought it would be just a very simple fix. I thought that they would go in, take the battery out, send her home, and, you know, we'd be back to our normal life, and we'd be preaching at camp. And it was several hours later, and we had stopped in Mississippi, me and Kyle, and for the night. And Amy had texted me and just said, "Chad, they took the battery out, but she's on a ventilator and she's in ICU." And at that moment, I knew this was a little bit more than just taking a battery out. Something was going on and something was taking place. And I had to make a phone call, a difficult phone call, but yet one that I knew was best for our family. And I just called the camp director and told him what was going on and I needed to go home. And of course, you know the story. We came home and in the hospital for almost 2 weeks, 12 days. And she was on a ventilator. She was able to come off of that a couple days later and started doing well. That button battery began, that corrosion of that battery really eats that esophagus. And throughout the time, they said the whole reason that they're being so slow and very careful to her eating again and all that, they said the corrosion could eat through the esophagus. And the aorta, as we know, sits behind the esophagus. And they said it could eat through the aorta and have an aorta rupture. We were in the hospital there for 12 days and began a liquid diet and just a slow, soft diet. And they really, they took several MRIs and they didn't see a lot of healing there, but they really felt like the doctors did that the healing was still, it was very slow, but it was healing and it was getting back, not to normal, but where they felt safe to let us go. And as you know, we went on vacation for a week. We got out of the hospital on a Friday. We left on Saturday to head to our family vacation. On Sunday evening, all of a sudden, Kyle gets very sick and ended up so much so that we felt like we needed to take him to the emergency room. And he was fighting kidney stones. And we didn't know that. It scared us to death. Here we are, been in the hospital for 2 weeks and now back in the hospital. And we enjoyed a great week after that episode with Kyle and finally thought we were back on the path of healing and back to our regular schedule. You know how we do. And may I mind you, all of this is going on in the craziness of what we've been going through in the church with the virus and in our community. And just the ups and downs of that, you know how that's been, church and the closing of the church and several months ago and trying to keep our church family safe. And so we're juggling all of these things and those very difficult decisions and going through all of this. And by the way, I'm sharing all this not as a pity party. I'm sharing this and you'll see where I'm going in a moment. The way I pray that it will encourage you in what you're going through and what you're struggling with. Because the truth of the matter is we all have our battles and we all have our struggles. And no matter what you go through and what you're dealing with, it's an emergency. It's serious. And it doesn't matter what my testimony, our story is and what yours is. The truth is we all have our valley days and our storms. And so I want to encourage us. But so here we are. We're on vacation. Had a wonderful time. The kids get back. And, of course, they head off to camp. And on Thursday, June 23rd, I believe that's 25 days since the initial injury, what the doctor said could happen it did happen. And on that Thursday, we, by God's grace, God spared Ivy's life. Of course, you know the story there. We were in a staff meeting, actually sitting in this room here, me and several of the staff, and we were planning out our August and our fall and excited, still excited. And we're still excited, planning, looking at our new outreach program, our new discipleship program, that we're excited, some men's discipleship, ladies' discipleship, a whole bunch of things that we're planning and preparing. Had the marker board out, working through some things, and all of those things, just excited about the fall and what God's doing. And I get a phone call. It rang a couple times. I didn't recognize the phone number, and I get a phone call, and I finally said, I need to answer this. Someone's called me a couple times, and I answered, and it was the ambulance service, and it said, we are calling for your wife. There's been an accident at your home. And obviously, those are words no one wants to hear. And my wife wanted to call you. I immediately called her, and she's, of course, in frantic mode. Chad, it's bad. Chad, it's bad. Chad, it's bad. Please get home. And Ivy has fallen on the floor, and she began, and I'll spare all the details, but just a very horrific scene there as her aorta ruptured. And you can imagine that coming out. And they life flighted her. They had to take her and life flight her. I did get there. The helicopter came in there at Rock Springs and was able to spend a little time with Ivy, and could tell she was very, very sick. And we kind of began thinking maybe what the doctor said could happen has happened. We thought we were in the clear. The doctors thought we were in the clear. And we just began praying and asking God to spare that little girl's life. What we found out, that corrosion was still active in her esophagus, and it did go through the walls of her esophagus, and it hit her aorta and had the aorta rupture. And it was only by God's grace that Ivy made it to the hospital. Even to this day, the doctors are still amazed. Just happened again the other day. They said, that girl is a lucky girl. And the truth is, most folks don't survive when the aorta ruptures like that. You just bleed out so fast. It's only by God's grace we made it to the hospital somehow. Well, we know who, but the bleeding stopped long enough for us to get to the hospital. And I've thought about it many times. I thought God just put his finger in that little hole and he stopped it. And now they rush her into the emergency room, and they said, we've got to do emergency surgery and try to stop that. And they took us to the waiting room. And it was there in that waiting room. It was just Amy and I. We'd come out of already a couple weeks in the hospital. We had dealt with Kyle. We had dealt with stuff here at the church. And just all that's been going on, we've all been dealing with. And I just sat there in that waiting room and just said, God, I need to hear from you. And I'll never forget sitting there and I just kind of rocking back and forth. And we were just begging God to be with Ivy and to touch her body. And I remember I said, God, I need a verse. I need something that you would comfort me with, that I can share with my wife during this time. And as we sat there for what we seemed like days, it was about an hour and a half or so. It felt like 2 or 3 days. In the quietness of that waiting room, God brought to mind a very familiar verse, a verse we've all heard, but a verse that night became alive in my life. And tonight, I want to share that with you. And tonight, I want to encourage you, because no matter what you're going through, no matter what you're dealing with, no matter what you're walking through, God wants to help us. And for the next two Wednesdays, I want to speak on this thought. I pray that it will be a help to us. And I want to share this very, very, very familiar verses with you. You all know them. You've memorized them. I've read it hundreds of times. Something about that night, God showed this to me, and it's helped me over these last several weeks. And here it is. Take your Bibles out, and I want you to turn to Proverbs chapter 3. Please take your Bible, turn to Proverbs chapter 3. This would be a help to you this evening. Proverbs chapter 3. tonight. And I want you to see what the Bible says as we turn here to Proverbs chapter 3. And I want you to notice verse 5, what the Bible says. And you already know it. Listen to this. Proverbs 3, verse 5. And here it is. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. Verse 6. In all thy ways acknowledge him. Not acknowledge me, not acknowledge the doctors, not acknowledge all that's going on in this world, but acknowledge him. It's Christ, it's God, it's our Savior, that's the Lord. And he and God, he shall direct thy path. As God gave me those verses, just brought those to mind there in that waiting room. And I began repeating those verses over and over in my mind. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Chad, trust in the Lord. Amy, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not, Chad, lean not unto thine own understanding. Don't try to figure it out because you're not. But Chad, in all thy ways, acknowledge me, acknowledge the Lord, and I'll direct your path. And I'll direct your path. Tonight, every one of us has dealt with some type of situation that's rattled us. Over this past year, 2020 is nothing what we thought it would be like. It's been a very difficult year, if I can be real honest with you. Let's just be real honest. It's been difficult. We're not trying to sugarcoat it. I know we're to trust the Lord, and I'm going to get there in a moment. It's just been a difficult year for many. I think for all, in some way or another. We've all experienced our own hurts, our own trials, our own pains. The truth of the matter is, we will continue to as we walk this earth. And here's the thing, is 2020... As we close out 2020 in the next several months and we go into 2021, it's not going to change. Because this earth, as we walk this earth, there will be trials and heartaches and hurts. But here's the thing, I believe more and more, we need to take Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 and we need to allow it to minister to our lives. Something that I do as I read my Bible is I'll take some verses and passage and I'll just read it over and over and over again. I try to let it meditate on it. And I want to read these verses again. And as I do, and whatever you're dealing with tonight, did you think about these verses? Listen to this. As we sat in that waiting room, not knowing if our little blessing was going to make it, God said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thine own understanding, in all thy ways acknowledge him. He shall direct thy paths tonight. We just have a few moments here. I just want to speak on this thought of trusting in the Lord. And we'll take these verses for the next two Wednesdays and we'll kind of dissect them and just share some thoughts here tonight. You know, as we break down these two verses, we notice four powerful statements. It's kind of obvious here. It's kind of an automatic break of four different breaks here in these verses. Number one is trust in the Lord. Number two is lean not into thine own understanding. We're going to talk about these in the days ahead, between today and next week. So trust in the Lord. Lean not into thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, there in verse 6, and he shall direct thy path. So you see four powerful statements right there clearly in these verses. As we read these two verses, we find the word trust really is the key word in these verses for the believer. That word trust. When you think about trust, it's a word that we use so often, but what does it mean? Just a simple search on Google, you'll get a definition. I want you to think about this. Google says this about trust. It's a firm belief in the reliability, truth, ability, or strength of someone or something. Firm belief in the reliability, truth, ability, or strength of someone or something. That's trust. Solomon says here in Proverbs, he says, trust in the Lord. That's the key component of these verses, is trusting in the Lord. You see what I thought? God is reliable. God is truth. Our God is utterly dependable, is He not? Now think about this. Listen, this is what God showed me as we sat in the waiting room, and as we're walking through these days, and we're still walking through, and I'll share at the end here of what's still ahead of us. And really, this incident that happened at the end of June has really now become a lifelong injury, just to be real honest with you. And so we're going to have to trust in the Lord. You know, God is dependable. His character makes it impossible for Him to lie. His wisdom, God's wisdom, is so great, He can never make a mistake. When we're walking through our valley days and we think, God, what's going on? Can I say, God never makes a mistake. Our God can be trusted. He has high and holy purposes and no ulterior motives. His love is limitless. He can never be unkind. One preacher said this about God. He said, God, He will never let us go. He never lets us down, and He'll never let us off. He will never let us go, never let us down, and never let us off. That's our God. Trust in the Lord tonight. So tonight, no matter what we're going through, no matter a sickness, no matter a financial situation, no matter the death or the hurt of a loved one, listen, we can trust in the Lord. We can trust in Him. By the way, get this, we must trust in Him. This is what I'm learning. Not only can we trust in Him, we must trust in Him. And by the way, anything less than that is an insult to God. Whew, that's powerful. Anything less than trusting in Him is an insult to God. Because God says, hey, you can trust in me. I'm dependable. You can count on me. I am truth. Trust in me. And we're to trust in Him with all of our heart. How are we doing this evening in this area? You say, preacher, it's not easy. No, it's not. I'm sharing with you my struggle. I'm sharing with you our story, our testimony of what we're walking through and what we're still walking. Isn't it amazing how we can trust in God with our salvation? But then trusting in Him for our everyday needs and all that we're going through is difficult. It's a daily decision. We're going to talk about those things. But I want us to see this, first of all. I wrote this down. What trusting in God does not mean. And I want to share these, and then we'll close up tonight and we'll finish the story or finish the message on next Wednesday. But I want us to begin with what trusting in God does not mean. What does it not mean? Can I say this first of all? What trusting in God does not mean, and here it is, that everything will go the way we planned or want it to go. That's what trusting in God does not mean. That everything that we will go through, it will go our way and how we planned it. Sometimes I believe we think that just because we're saved, just because we're faithful to church, just because we serve God, just because we give, just because we witness, that everything will go our way. I believe we all could say 2020 is not how we planned. Sometimes we can look at Proverbs 3:5, this very familiar passage, and think, Lord, I'm putting into place what You've said in Proverbs, and I am trusting in You today, so may my trusting must mean everything is going to be picture perfect. Since I'm trusting in You today, God, my life is going to be a picture-perfect life. Can I remind us something? Because here's something we need to get. What trusting in God does not mean, it does not mean that everything will go the way we planned or want it to go. Can I remind us what John 16:33 says? This is Jesus speaking to the disciples. If you have a red-letter edition Bible, it's in red. It's Jesus speaking. Listen to these verses. Or this verse, John 16:33. These things have I spoken unto you, that ye might have peace. In the world Ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You see this? In the world, ye shall have tribulation. Sadly, some people think that believing in God does entitle them to a problem-free life. Sadly, there's TV evangelists, hey, that says that. Hey, if you'll give, everything's going to go great. Everything's going to be wonderful. Give your life to God and you'll have no more problems. That's not true. Trusting in God, it does not mean everything will go our way. If people do have problems, they think that either they don't have enough faith or God is not holding up his end of the bargain. The Bible shows us over and over of how great men of faith, men who trusted in God, still endured great hardships. And just because they trusted God didn't mean everything went their way. How about Joseph? He trusted in God, but he lived in a pit. He trusted in God, but he spent time in a prison. How about Daniel? He trusted in God. He didn't bow down. Hey, he didn't honor Nebuchadnezzar. What did he do? He trusted God, but yet he still had to live in a pit in the lion's den. How about Abraham? He trusted in God, but yet he didn't have a child. And then when God gave him a child, Isaac, God wanted him to go to the and sacrifice him. What about Moses? Over and over we find difficult days he walked through. Paul, Peter, John, and how about Jesus himself? Oh, he's our example. You see, trusting in God tonight, please get this, doesn't mean everything's going to go well. Doesn't mean our health's always going to be there. Doesn't mean that we're not going to walk through valley days. Doesn't mean that we're not going to get phone calls and hear that dreaded word, cancer. Doesn't mean that we're going to hear that our loved ones passed away or there's been an accident and as I picked up that phone call, and that ambulance driver said, there's been an accident at your home. And at that moment, everything stops. You see, we're all just a phone call away. We're all just a phone call away. What valley are you going through? What pain are you dealing with? What storm are you walking through at this moment? Can I say this? Trust in the Lord. What trusting in God does not mean, it does not mean that everything will go the way you and I see fit. Trusting in God does not mean that. Let me say this also. Trusting in God does not mean that God will explain everything that's going on in our life. Here's what I found out over these past months. Starting back when the virus hit several months ago, then the accident with Ivy, Kyle's bout with kidney stones, and even some other things that we were dealing with our family. This is what I realized. God doesn't owe me any explanation to why he is doing what he's doing. God doesn't owe me an explanation. You know what? We want to say why, but God doesn't owe us an explanation. I don't know why we're going through what we're going through. I don't know why we're dealing with what we're dealing with. When Solomon, the wisest man on earth, said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, he doesn't mean our trust in God will keep us from trials and trusting in God and trusting in God will give us an explanation to all that we're going through. God doesn't owe you and I an explanation when life is painful and confusing. Believe me, I've had my moments just as you have. When bad things happen, really bad things happen, many of us are tempted to ask why. That's not necessarily wrong to ask why, but here's what we need to realize. God's not always going to tell us why. We're not going to know until we get to heaven. Yet when God says to trust him, we're to truly put our trust in him, knowing we will face hardships and knowing him and knowing he will not always explain himself, and we must come to the conclusion that that's okay. It's okay, God. You don't have to explain it to me. By the way, God didn't answer Job when he asked, why me? What does trusting in God mean in the life of Job? Once again, Job, we know the story of Job. He's a classic example of trust. He lost everything. Once he had been rich, now he was poor. He had been blessed with a lovely family and boys and girls, and now he was bereaving them. He had enjoyed good health. Now he was afflicted with a horrible disease. Hey, his wife stood by him at one time, and now she advised him to curse God and die. At one time, he had been highly honored. Now he was viewed suspicious. Once he had his integrity had been unquestioned, now even his friends accused him of secret sins. Once he walked in communion with God, and now he appealed passionately to a silent heaven. Job had no explanation to offer for the dreadful disasters that had overtaken him and overwhelmed him. But he knew God, and he said there in Job 13:15, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him." So trusting in the Lord tonight does not mean everything will go our way, or that God will even give us an explanation. What are you facing this evening? Though it's not easy, we can put our trust in him. Remember, he is God. He is in control. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. It rains on the just and the unjust. The journey will that we live in will bring heartache, but it will also bring great happiness. We just need to learn to trust him. Next week, we'll take a time and we'll look at what it means to trust him. And I pray it will be a help to us as we continue to journey this very challenging days that we're going through. How do we trust him? We'll look at all of those things. How do we trust him when all that's going on around us is taking place? We'll look at those things and on next week and help us. I would ask that you continue to pray for Ivy. What we've discovered on the outside, she looks great. She looks very healthy, but on the inside, she's very sick. The injury to her esophagus and aorta is a very serious one. As a matter of fact, it's so serious and complex because doctors don't typically do this because typically someone doesn't survive. They've taught, they've communicated with many doctors and tried to get counsel. And so the heart doctor, matter of fact, came in a couple days ago while Amy was there and just said once again how lucky we were. And we know it wasn't luck. God protected her. But he did say that the surgery that they'll be doing in a few weeks will be very serious. She will have heart surgery to repair her aorta. Also repairing her esophagus in the why it had corroded. They kind of welded together, so they've got to get them loose. There's just worries there. Will that loosening, taking them apart, will it open up anything? They've got to take the stent out. There's just a lot of things there, unknowns, that they really don't know till they get in. And but we know this, God is able. And so we're thankful for that. We're going to continue to be praying for her, be praying for those during this time. Tonight, will you join me in prayer as we continue to pray for the sick, the hurting, pray for our church, pray for our world, and may we continue to trust in the Lord. Listen to these verses. Please get this. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. You see, we, once again, trusting in God does not mean everything will go our way and that God's going to give us an explanation of why. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding. Verse 6, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. On that Thursday night, as we sat in that waiting room and over, that verse kept going through my mind. And God brought a great comfort to me and to my wife. And even on that next day, was able to use those verses in someone else's life to help them with what they were going through. And tonight, church, as we close, may we determine to trust in the Lord with all of our hearts. I love you, church. I'm praying for you. Very difficult days. But I would say this. This pastor yearns to be back together. I do apologize. May we continue to lift our church up in prayer. God bless you. Have a wonderful evening.